close.
Yeah, it is. What's quite fortunate, though, is when they developed the town after the war, that they did use the footprint of the camp. So some of the roads that were built by the British, still exist today.
Oh, right.
And the houses were built around that footprint. I think when the nurses got here, some of them would have had quite a shock, because this is definitely what you would call active service conditions. They were coming out of an ordinary building into a vast, hutted and tented camp. Two-thirds of this hospital was huts. A third were, you can call them tents, huge marquees.
For Vera, one of the most distressing things she had to deal with at Etaples was the increasing number of victims of poisonous mustard gas.
I have a letter here that Vera wrote to her mother on December the 5th, 1917. She says, I wish those people who write so glibly
about this being a holy war, and so much about going on no matter how long the war lasts, could see the poor things burnt, blistered all over with great mustard-coloured blisters, with blinded eyes, sometimes temporarily, sometimes permanently, all sticky and stuck together. Their voices a mere whisper, saying that their throats are closing and they know they will choke.
We're terrible for the patients and terrible for the nurses as well. A nurse's job is to ease distress, you know, to help the patient, and there they're faced with men with a whole multitude of symptoms.
Was the pain relief fairly basic then?
They would have morphine. Really, there was not much between an aspirin and morphine, you know, so not the sort of pain relief that we would expect now. And these wounds were the sort that were not very easy to relieve, because every time you moved, you would have another acutely painful blister, and it was going to do nothing for your eyes. It wasn't going to stop you being blind or stop them watering.
The horrific nature of the gas wounds made a huge impact on Vera, as did another aspect of war that she had not anticipated.
One somewhat incongruous situation Vera found herself in at Etaples was when she was put to work nursing German prisoners of war on the German ward. And suddenly all thoughts of them being the enemy just slipped away. In fact, she says in a letter to her parents, I cannot, however, really say I dislike nursing the prisoners, though I should have expected to had I thought of it.
One forgets they are the enemy and only remembers that they are suffering human beings. To think Edward in one part of France is trying to kill the same people whom in another part of France I am trying to save. The less one hates them, the more one realizes the tragedy of war.
This seems to me to be a really important turning point for Vera. The seeds of pacifism are beginning to be sown, and she's coming to terms with the real futility of war and the realisation that if someone needs nursing care, they need nursing care, whoever they are and whichever side they're on.
In November 1917, Edward's regiment was sent to the Italian front. Edward and his men must have felt some relief to leave the mud for the mountain passes of Italy. And Vera took comfort in the fact that the Italian front seemed a far safer place to be than northern France. However, back in London, her mother had suffered a nervous breakdown. Vera had to choose between her duties to her country and to her family. She decided to leave nursing and France and return home.
On the 22nd of June, 1918, Vera was having tea with her father when there was a sudden loud clattering on the door.
For a moment, I thought that my legs would not carry me, but they behaved quite normally as I got up and went to the door. I knew what was in the telegram. I opened it and read it in a tearing anguish of suspense. Regret to inform you, Captain E.H. Brittain, M.C., killed in action, Italy, June the 15th. As we went back into the dining room, I saw, as though I had never seen them before, the bowl of blue delphiniums on the table. Their intense colour, vivid, ethereal, seemed too radiant for earthly flowers.
Thank you. This was the final catastrophe. After so many deaths, after witnessing so much injury and having watched her own family suffer, the one person she had clung to was wrenched from her. Vera's friends were representative of the group of officers who at very best only ever had a 50% chance of survival. Trained as leaders, the officers' distinctive tailored uniforms and lack of rifles meant they were easy pickings for German snipers. Edward's name is one of the 430 First World War dead on the memorial in Buxton.
There's his name on the memorial cross, Captain Edward Brittain, MC. My mother really had hoped, given that everybody else had been killed, that he at least would survive. She felt that he was so precious to her. And when he died, she wrote, "I say goodbye to the last of all I cared for."
It's unimaginable, really, isn't it? And losing
everybody.
Almost everybody.
Yes, that's right.
It's just so...
I mean, all her generation of men was gone, as far as she was concerned, both her best friends and her fiancé and her brother. So it was as if the whole of life was drained.
Do you think she was ever at risk of just kind of giving in and just...
Yes, I think at that point she really was. When the armistice came on November the 11th, 1918, she told me that it gave her no delight at all, no pleasure. Everybody was cheering and dancing and shouting their heads off, but she felt no association with it at all, no sense of being part of it, just a feeling of utter loneliness and tragedy.
In one of her last writings, Vera, commemorating the 50th anniversary of the armistice, invoked the memory of Uppingham as a symbol of a vanished world of pre-war innocence.
The echo of a boy's laughing voice on a school playing field in that golden summer. The sound of the Uppingham School Choir marching up the chapel for the speech day service in July 1914 and singing of the commemoration hymn. There was a thrilling, a poignant quality in those boys' voices, as though they were singing their own requiem, as indeed many of them were.
The First World War not only robbed Vera Brittain of her peers and of her youth, it stole away time she could have spent at university with friends, and it took her brother and her fiancé.
Later, Vera would write,
"I could have married Victor in memory of Roland and Geoffrey in memory of Edward, but the war took even the second best. It left nothing. Only ambition held me to life."
And then in the 20s, the idea of writing about her experiences emerged. And in the process of writing, Vera began to see the war in a totally different way. No longer through the eyes of a youthful idealist, but from the perspective of someone whose hopes and ambitions had been crushed. Vera became a pacifist, and she used her account of the First World War as a warning to generations to come.
"90 Years of Remembrance" continues tonight over on BBC Four. Jeremy Paxman tells the story of poet Wilfred Owen at 7, followed later by new drama about the first black officer to lead British troops during World War I. Walter's War is at 9. You can share your memories by going online to the BBC's Remembrance website.